Test.
Just want to remind you, we reached the appointed hour. If you'll come on in and find your seat, we'll get started. work well, you know. It's my privilege to introduce to you the district lay leader for the Central West District, at least for the next few weeks. Where'd you go? I missed you. He's also leader, finance chair, and stewardship chair here at McEachern, Randy Hardy, and he's going to come and make a presentation.
Okay, so good morning. I had one of the pastors that I was talking to says it's hard to get pastors. It is like herding cats. So anyway, my name, as Craig said, I'm the Central West lay leader. This morning, before Adam Hamilton is introduced, I have the honor of doing something really cool for a warm-up. About 2 months ago, our senior pastor, Craig, he made the decision to use one of Adam's books. A lot of you probably have used the one Enough as our stewardship emphasis. And Craig named his sermon series More Than Enough to parallel Adam's study materials. As we began our church-wide study, the man who over here, Connor Garman, who has been playing for you guys this morning, he told us that he became unsettled. Kind of a word that we don't hear. He told us that the book that had inspired the sermon series also inspired him on another note. Another note. You get it? To write a song. Here's the thing, though. Connor has never written a song. He's so talented. In his own words, this is his words, he said, "It is the first song I feel like I have ever been inspired to write by the Holy Spirit. So I worked on it without much sleep until I got it right." So praise God for our connected inspirations in the UMC. And thank you, Adam Hamilton, for starting this inspiration.
I fall to my knees and just cry. Not for the things that you've given to me, but the little I've given to you. You see, nothing in my whole life could amount to an offering worthy of you. Oh, Jesus, you are more than enough. So many questions and doubts, sometimes fears, have flooded my mind every day. I say, God, why'd you do this? I don't understand. Do you want me to just run away? But you are the gentle, kind shepherd who's known me for my whole life. And you, Jesus, you are more than enough. Jesus, you are more than enough. Why do I try to do this alone? You are the one who touches the sick and the poor. If I could tell the world one thing, it would be that your love, your love, your love is more than enough. peace. Blameless Lamb of Calvary, who died so sinners could be freed. How could you still want us when all we are is hard to trust? You are God and we are men, and all that is to your plan. Saved by grace through faith alone, grace, how can it be? For your grace is more than enough. Oh, Jesus, you're more than enough. Why do I try to do this alone? You are the one who touches the sick and the poor. If I could tell the world one thing, it would be that your love is more than enough. Start to forget, and that part of my memory fades. No power, no scheme, no, not any one thing can take you out of my heart. When I take that last breath, and your face is all I see, I will say, just one look will never be enough. Oh, Jesus, you're more than enough. Why do I try to do this alone? You are the one who touches the sick and the poor. If I could tell is more than enough. He's always been enough.
Thank you, Connor. Hi again, my name is Craig Hatoa. I'm the senior pastor here at McEachern Memorial United Methodist Church. Welcome. On behalf of my senior associate, Cindy Bloxage, the entire staff, and our entire congregation, welcome. We're so glad you're here today. I know that some of you drove a little bit of distance through the rain, and so we're especially glad that you could be here today for this very special time. We have a number of volunteers, a number of our lay folk who've wanted to be here this morning and to serve you, and a lot of them have this big button that says, Ask Me. So if you need anything, ask them, and they will be glad to help you in any way that they can. Again, I'm so glad that you're here. Welcome this morning. I want to now invite Alice Rogers, who is the director for the Center for Clergy Excellence, to come and to pray and to introduce our morning special guest. Alice.
Good morning, everyone. It is so great to see colleagues and the lay people of McEachern United Methodist Church who are here together. As Robert Brown said this morning, you know, as part of the connection, we are here to lean in and to lean on. And I can look out today and see so many of you for whom I have leaned on, and I'm grateful for all of you. And I give thanks that we can be here together today through the efforts of Reverend Dr. Jessica Terrell and Reverend Blake Trent, who have worked very hard to put this event together. The Center for Clergy Excellence partnered with them, and the backbone of that department is Michelle Levan and Lee Martin, and they have been working very hard. Yes, give them a shout out. They've been selling lots of books, and they're in the back, so if you would like to get one of Adam Hamilton's books that you don't yet have, they're back there. But let us open up with a word of prayer before I introduce Reverend Hamilton, and let us give thanks that we can be here together as part of the connection of the United Methodist Church. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious God, we do indeed feel the power of your Holy Spirit in this sacred place where we have gathered together to celebrate your love for all people, to celebrate the grace that you pour out upon all people, and for the opportunity that we all have to work together to share the kingdom of God with everyone. And we are grateful that we can be here today to hear one of your servants who has poured his life out for you in so many ways speak to us the words that you have given to him. We give you thanks for Adam. We give you thanks for his leadership, not only in the in Kansas City, but the United States and also around the world. Lord, we give you thanks for his witness, for his courage, for the way in which he speaks out on behalf of your love and grace for all people. So we give you thanks, God, that we can be here together today, and we do pray that you will pour out your Spirit upon each and every one of us so that when we leave here, we will continue to be inspired to love you, serve you, and to share that with all people. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. It is my privilege this morning to introduce to you someone I'm sure all of you know. All of you have read books by him, but Reverend Adam Hamilton. He's the founding pastor of the United Methodist Church of the Resurrection in the Kansas City area. He grew up in the Kansas City area, earned a BA degree in pastoral ministry from Oral Roberts and a Master Divinity degree from Southern Methodist University. And while he was there, he was awarded the B'nai B'rith Award in Social Ethics. Hamilton was named one of the 10 people to watch in America's spiritual landscape by Religion and Ethics News Weekly. And for his efforts in Kansas City, he has been recognized with the first Founders Civility Award by American Public Square at Jewell. In 2023, William Jewell College awarded him with the individuals and as a church. Thought-provoking, outward-focused, bridge-building, and hope-radiating. Let's give Adam a great round of applause as we welcome him to come.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It's great to be with you today. I'm really, really glad you're here. I'm glad, Connor, you were playing again. I want to come up here where I can see you. So I had asked Jessica this morning, I said, I need to get Connor's email address or some contact. It was so awesome last night when you sang this, and I didn't get a chance to thank you afterwards, but thank you, and I'm so glad to get to hear it again today. Beautiful, really beautiful song, really touched my heart, and I know everyone else too. So Connor, thank you for sharing your gift of music with us. All right, I'm gonna ask you to do the thing that nobody wants to have to do, but I'm gonna wonder if, like, halfway back, would you all come up and get a little closer? Because I envision this as a conversation, and we're gonna actually just converse with each other, and that way I can see you, you can see me. So if you're like, where this microphone is back, I know you hate it. I'm so sorry. But you're pastors. You can deal with it. Come on up a little closer to the front if you don't mind. That would be awesome. We got a whole pew right here in the front. All right, thank you. So I'm delighted to have a chance to be with you all today, and I am looking forward to our time, and I'm hoping this is both fun, informative, inspirational, and also a chance for you to connect with each other. So we're gonna have conversations around. I'm gonna ask you some questions, ask you to have conversations with your colleagues, and just delighted again to have a chance to be here in this area. And hearing the story of this church is a remarkable thing as well. So I had not, most of you know the story of the congregation, but it is an amazing testimony. And the people hearing that there's, I think they had 100 new members join this last year, got a whole lot of folks planning to join in the coming year. And it points to the importance of United Methodist churches and communities. And so I wanna start by inviting you to do something with me if you would. Would you just put your hands on your lap like this? And I'd like to invite you to whisper under your breath this prayer. Thank you, God, for today. Thank you for your love and grace. Thank you for your calling on my life. Thank you for everything. Open my ears to hear and my heart to receive all that you have for me today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we've been through an interesting time in ministry the last 5 years. I don't think any of us now, going into 2019 General Conference, that seemed like the worst thing that could happen in General Conference. I have been a delegate. This will be my 8th General Conference coming up in a couple of weeks. And I remember coming away from that just so deflated and discouraged. One of the local media in Kansas City called me live on the radio. They were live and they were like, so what happened? And like, I'm not a crier, but I'm standing there on the floor of the General Conference and I'm trying to talk to these people. And I just started crying. Like, I've just watched my church ripped apart, and I've watched policies get put into place that are gonna hurt people that I love dearly. And I just have no words for it right now. I love this church. I became a United Methodist on purpose. When I was 18 years old, I was baptized Catholic. I was Methodist for a few years when I was a kid. I didn't really take. And then I was an atheist for a little while, at least that's what I thought when I was in my teens. Early teens, and then I came to faith in a little Pentecostal church. And when I was 18 years old at Oral Roberts University, with a lot of questions swirling around in my head, particularly after two of my closest friends were electrocuted and killed, I found myself thinking, I'm not really cut out to be a fundamentalist. And I got so many questions, and my pastor at my church in Tulsa kept telling me, don't ask so many questions, just take it by faith. And it's like, I can't, I'm sorry. This doesn't make any sense to me. And right now I'm really angry at God. If there is a God. And while I'm here studying at Oral Roberts University to be a pastor, right now I'm not sure I could be a pastor. I'm not even sure I could be a Christian. And I need answers. And I began, trying to figure out where do I turn to for answers if my pastor is telling me not to ask questions. And I thought, I was baptized Catholic. Maybe I should be a Catholic. But I got married the week after high school graduation, and it really sort of set aside the Catholic priest option. Some Anglicans get to do that, but generally Pentecostals don't get to become Catholic priests when they're already married. And I thought, well, I was a Methodist for a few years as a kid. I wonder what they believe. And I went to the library at Oral Roberts University. I checked out the most authoritative book I could find on Methodism. It was called the United Methodist Book of Discipline. And I began reading it, and I started at the very beginning in the historical statement. And I thought, wow, that is really cool. Like a church that started on the campus of Oxford University, a movement that started on the campus of Oxford University. It was led by somebody who was leading a revival, but he was in Oxford. We might call them professors today. He was a fellow at Lincoln College. That the founders of that movement were all college students who wanted to know as much as they could about the world and about life and philosophy, but they also wanted to know Jesus. And I thought, man, that is the kind of church I've been looking for. Where you don't check your brain at the door, where you're meant to be critical thinkers and engaged. And I thought, that's awesome. And then I started reading about the Wesleyan revival and what was happening, the Methodist revival, and they were serving the poor, and they were seeing their role as not just leading people to faith in Jesus, but also going out and trying to help the world look like the kingdom of God. And I thought, wow, I never heard a sermon about that in my little Pentecostal church. It was all about caring for the people inside the church, but I never really heard much about going out and serving in the world. And then I read the theological statement, the doctrinal, our doctrinal statements, our theological task, and I thought, this is beautiful. And but my recollections were going to a Methodist church as a kid, and it didn't seem that lively. It seemed a little, compared to the Pentecostals, it seemed a little dry. And I started visiting Methodist churches, and they seemed a little dry still. And some of them were in decline, and I began thinking, okay, but there's this beautiful story in the Book of Discipline. I wonder if it could be like that again, you know, where these churches would be reaching people. And I thought, this is the kind of gospel that I'm looking for, and I'm guessing that there are other people are going to feel the same way. For me, I went through a deconstruction in 1982. Well, that's a term that's used a lot anymore. I don't know if you all use it down here, but largely of conservative and fundamentalist and evangelical, conservative evangelicals who were questioning their faith and deconstructing it. And some of them just lose their faith altogether, but others, you know, begin to replace what they had torn apart and they find something new. And that's where I was. And so I was an ex-evangelical before it was cool to be an ex-evangelical. And I came to love this church. That was, I was 18, and today I'm, by the way, in the Pentecostal church, when you go from the, back then, when you went from the Pentecostal church to the United Methodist Church, you were backsliding. They're like, what happened to you? How come you, how'd you lose your faith? I'm like, no, I found my faith. So anyway, I love this church, and I have been, my hope has been to see it revive and grow and be dynamic, and it's fun to see that around the country and around the world. But the last 5 years has been really hard. Really more than 5 years. It started years and years ago when a group of folks proposed at one general conference I was at that we have an amicable separation. And the general conference voted that down pretty quickly. But they kind of kept going, gnawing away at it, you know. So general conference was discouraging in 2019. And then we got into the real fun, you know. We had an election that was highly divisive and January 6th, and we had COVID. And we had George Floyd's murder, and we had cities, you know, with, you know, cars burning in the cities. We hadn't seen in a number of years in America, not since I was a little kid. And then disaffiliations. And you survived. This is what I want to say. You are still here. You survived. You didn't quit. Did any of you feel like quitting the last few years? Yeah, I have never felt more like retiring than I did in the last 5 years. And so I thought, I'll just go write books, and I'll go speak, and I'll, you know, this is just not fun anymore. And it wasn't fun, the nasty letters and emails I'd get from people and the crap that people were saying that wasn't true about United Methodism folks, I mean, all of that. And it didn't matter where I turned, no matter what I was speaking about. When we'd talk about Black Lives Matter and all of a sudden there were, you know, people who left the church. Then we'd talk about what's happening in the United Methodist Church. We'd talk about if you even hinted, you know, for some people that you weren't a Trump supporter, which I don't know where you all are, but I'm not a huge Trump fan, but I love him as a human being. But no matter what you did or what you said, you're gonna have people leave, and they were mad. Did you all have that in Atlanta too, in the North Georgia area? All right, I didn't know if it was just Kansas or if it happened everywhere. All right, and so you find yourself at points thinking, this is just not fun anymore. So I wanna tell you a little story. I'm gonna ramble today, because they gave me 2 hours, which I really appreciate. I've got a whole presentation, but I'm gonna share a few other things first. So the people who make a difference in the world are the people who don't give up when it's hard. And it gets hard if you're gonna be in leadership. So leadership is not easy. It's easy to be a follower, and then you can criticize the leaders for what they're doing. You always have a better way of doing it than they did. Have you noticed that about all the critics out there? You know, now I'm like, hey, here's the keys, and here's my badge, you take over, and let's just see how you do this. But you always have, and I remember years ago, the quarterback of the Kansas City Chiefs at the time was a guy named Trent Green, and he just moved to Kansas City, and I knew he was a United Methodist, and he'd had a rough couple of games at the beginning of the season, and the Kansas City Star had talked about what a lame choice they got for quarterback of the Chiefs, and this, you know, all of this kind of stuff. And I just sent him a note, and I said, hey, you don't know me. I heard from your pastor that you're a United Methodist, and I just wanted to say that leaders don't give up. And everybody who's done anything worth doing is criticized. So you go back all the way through the Bible and you find anybody who did anything worth doing was criticized. There were people who wanted to take them down. And the greatest example of that, of course, or the pinnacle example, is Jesus. And I think of John 6:66. That's an easy verse to remember, John 6:66, right? So that automatically feels a little ominous. And it was after Jesus said, I am the bread of life, and those who eat of me will never go hungry. And my flesh is, you know, the bread that I give is my flesh. And John 6:66, and many of his followers left him. And so I think, you know, Jesus knew what this was like. In any case, the story, and some of you have heard me share this before, but LaVon and I were going through a period, it was in 2004, if I'm not mistaken. And it was right before General Conference, and I thought, I'm gonna help our people understand what's coming at General Conference. So we talked about homosexuality, as the term is used in the Book of Discipline. And I had anticipated, I'd had kind of a way of seeing and understanding homosexuality for a long time. It was very gracious and generous and kind, but at the same time to say, but I don't think this is God's will for people. That came from a certain reading of the text. And I remember I was preparing the sermon to help our congregation think about this, and I thought I was gonna preach the same sermon I'd preached 4 years earlier. And but I asked our congregation to be able to share their stories with me. If you have any stories, please share them. I had a ream of stories that were sent to me. Our congregation is a pretty good sized church, and so we had a lot of people, gay and lesbian people in our congregation, parents of gay and lesbian people. And I'm reading these stories, and my heart was already changing in terms of how I was seeing scripture, but I was reading these stories, and I remember it's 1 a.m. and I'm crying in my living room. I mean, I'm literally laying down flat on the floor, and I'm like, God, these are your people. And the way I've understood the scriptures in the past cannot be right. These are your children. And so I went back to church that Sunday, and I preached this sermon. It was a different sermon that I'd preached before, and it was a sermon that said, I don't fully understand everything about this that I thought I knew. I thought I was pretty clear, and now my views are changing a bit. My views have changed a little bit on scripture over time, not related to homosexuality, but related to violence in the Bible, and slavery in the Bible, and women in the Bible, and a whole host of other things that have led me to think that scripture is a little more complex than I initially thought. When I was in the Pentecostal church where God said it, I believe it, that settles it. And I said, I think that's true here too. And so, you know, this, if you heard the sermon, you'd go, well, that wasn't any big deal. But we had 800 people left the church that year. And even at Resurrection in 2004, that was a lot of people. And I remember being so stinking depressed. I'm like, these are people I led to faith in Jesus. You know, these are people who say, I don't trust you to teach my children anymore. You know, and it was just painful. And I remember one night, we live in the country, and we have had horses at the time. And LaVon and I are mucking out the stalls of the barn in the evening. It's about 25 degrees out. And I turned to her and I said, are you okay if I take another job? Because this hurts too much. I can't do this anymore. And, you know, I thought we were the largest church in the denomination by 2004. And I thought, where am I going to go? And I really want to stay here. My family lives here and my kids have grown up here. I want to stay here. But the pain was just, it was hard emotionally. And I'm not prone to depression, but I was stinking depressed. And LaVon said something to me that was really important. She said, I'll go with you wherever you want to go. And I was getting job offers from outside of the, you know, local church, seminary presidents, and other kinds of things. And she said, I'll go with you wherever you go. I just have this one question to ask you. Is God calling you to leave, or are you running away? And it just hit me like, God wasn't calling me to leave. I just was running away. And I thought, okay, until God calls me to leave, I'm going to stay. And you know how this works, because even when you're depressed, when you go to church, you can't tell people you're depressed. How you doing, Pastor Adam? I'm doing awesome today, right? I'm doing great. And you know, you fake it and you say it because you know you can't tell them what you're really feeling. But it was about 6 months before that depression really lifted from me. And here's what I can tell you is that all of the coolest things that have happened at Church of the Resurrection have happened since that time. And I would have missed out on all of them if I'd quit. So sometimes God does call us to go move to somewhere else, you know, when things are really hard. Sometimes we may not be the right fit anymore, or we may need to be somewhere else. But sometimes God is just calling us to press through, because it's sometimes hard to be a leader. And so I really kind of wanted to start with that to say, I know we've all been through some really tough times the last couple of years, but what I'm feeling, and I don't know if you're feeling this yet, but every annual conference, every place that I've spoken, I've seen the same thing. There's an excitement that's brewing right now in the United Methodist Church. Like, you know, we don't all agree that the United Methodist Church is gonna be a church of the broad center. We're gonna have people center right and center left, and we've said that's okay to be on either side as long as you're gonna love people And you could be okay being in a church with people who might be in a little different place than you are in terms of same-sex marriage. At Resurrection, we have 30 elders on our staff, elders and deacons on our staff. And of those, some of them are ready to officiate at same-sex weddings right now, and they assist in them, not on site, because we've really been serious about following the discipline until we can't, and changing from within. But some of them are ready now, and I have a few have said, Adam, especially we've had some folks from the Nazarene Church who've joined. A lot of Nazarenes are interested in becoming United Methodist today. I don't know if you noticed that. But anyway, I had some of them say, I want to be a part of a church where everybody's included. I just am not sure that I'm ready yet to do at a wedding. Is that okay? Can I still be on staff? I'm like, yes. That's the kind of church we're trying to create right now. Is it a place where you're center right, center left, and in the middle? But we're committed that we can be in the same church together, and we can love one another, and we're committed to including everybody, even if we might be in different places when it comes to scripture. So my encouragement to you is to hang in there. And what I'm seeing, again, everywhere I'm going, I'm finding, and I'm hearing these stories. So Jessica was great, and I heard some stories last night from others about new life coming. This place is an example of that, where you're seeing there are people who need churches like ours, and there's something about knowing who are we, and what do we stand for? And it's not just about human sexuality and inclusion, it's about Jesus, but what do we stand for? And where we've decided, okay, the folks who are here want to be here, and we're not really gonna fight anymore. I'm excited about General Conference because I think, and I'll talk a little bit more in a few minutes about what's gonna happen at General Conference, or what I think will happen. But I believe that most of the delegates coming will be coming saying, how can we help this church have a great future? What is Jesus calling this church to do? And not people are waiting to see if they're gonna leave. I mean, there's a few still gonna be there, but generally speaking, the people are saying, I care about this church. And in the past, almost every vote at General Conference felt like a proxy vote for the debate and the conflict in our church. And today, I think our votes are gonna be what's best for the church and what's Jesus calling us to do. So that excites me a lot. All right, so we're gonna talk a little bit today about, start with General Conference. We're gonna talk about what it means to be a United Methodist. We're gonna talk about how do we reach the people who are no longer going to church. I'm gonna share with you a few things, just some things that we do at Resurrection that might be helpful for you. And we'll have some Q&A along the way. So we're gonna start with where are we in the United Methodist Church today? And guys, if you'll go ahead and go to the slides, and we're gonna go, where are we as a denomination? And let's go ahead and go to the next slide. So part of what I wanted you to see is just where things are across the United States. So this is, as near as I can tell, where we're at. 22,000 churches remain in the United Methodist Church, 74%. 14% have left the United Methodist Church and joined the Global Methodist Church. I think that's about 4,200 churches right now, although it's hard to actually get a full read on that, but I think that's about right. And about 3,500 churches went independent or they joined another denomination. So we have 22,000 United Methodist churches across the country. That's less than 30,000 that we used to have, but I'm not sure we actually had 30,000 United Methodist churches before. I think we had some Baptist churches that had a cross and flame on them. And that's okay. I love Baptists. People tell me I'm a Baptist Methodist. I appreciate. And you remember the River Runs Through It, where the Presbyterian pastor said the Methodists were Baptists who could read. And that's a slam on both Methodists and Baptists, I think. But it was. But there's a lot of passion I appreciate about the Baptists. But anyway, this is about where we are today. And just to get a sense of where the churches were that left. So in the state of Kansas, in Kansas and Nebraska, we had 1,100 churches, and I think we lost 22% of our churches. In the Great Plains Annual Conference, most of those were little churches. They were family chapels, they were smaller churches. They didn't like having to have a pastor appointed by somebody else. They wanted to get their own pastor, which will be interesting to see how well they do at that coming up. But they, most of them were those small churches. So even though we lost 22% of our churches, I think we lost 11% of our apportionments. And I love those little churches. I wish they had stayed. But that's where we were there. We've lost, I think our largest church was about 300 a Sunday in worship, a county seat church, which I know is different than down here, but in greater Kansas City area, we're on two conferences, the Missouri and the Great Plains Conference, and we had 110 churches in greater Kansas City. Within 30 miles of downtown, we lost two. One was a Korean church, and one was the second largest church in the Kansas City area. So you lost a lot more churches than we did in your conference, but my sense is, you lost some big ones, and there were some big fights over some of those big ones, and the rest of us watched across the country. And but I think a significant number of your churches were also smaller churches. And I don't know if you experienced this, I'm pretty sure you did. In Great Plains, there was a lot of things that were said about the United Methodist Church that simply weren't true. And that was very, very frustrating. And you had people come into a church, and you know what? Fear-mongering is really, that's just a tool that politicians and preachers can know how to use well, right, to scare people. Politicians are great at scaring you as to what's gonna happen if that other guy gets elected. And in the church, if you're not careful and you don't have integrity, you can make stuff up and scare people into thinking this is what the future is going to be. And I really hope to believe, I believe that some of the people who shared the false truths believed it was true. Otherwise, they were just lying. And I don't want to think that about them. So I think they actually believed that these were things that were going to happen. But I was in Tanzania in January, and we went to, there was a group of us went down to meet with delegates from the African conferences. And there was about 160 delegates at General Conference there. And my job was to ask and to dispel any false truths. And so I said, you know, I'm just here to, you know, like if you have questions, like what, tell me what you've heard. And one of the delegates told me, said, well, we were told that in America that you're gonna allow mothers to marry their sons and dads to marry their daughters. I'm like, who told you that? And I'm not gonna repeat who told him this, but it was just, it was like, really? Who would say that? How, you know, and so anyway, a lot of fear out there. But here's where we're at. We still have 22,000 churches. Now, some of those churches are not gonna make it, right? Some of those churches are going to, they were already declining. As a denomination, we've got a lot of churches where the average age is about 75. So they probably have 10 or 15 years left, unless they do something to turn things around, right? But this is where we're at. Denominationally across the globe, go to the next slide if you would. 82% of United Methodist churches, 35,000 churches remain United Methodist. Globally, very few have left so far. So there are 4,200 global United Methodist, global Methodist churches, 3,600 churches that are independent, and because very few globally have left, there are some that have left, but not a lot, and there's 35,000 churches across the denomination. Here's what we found in Tanzania is that at least the delegates and most of the bishops in Africa have said, we don't want to leave the United Methodist Church. We love the United Methodist Church, we want to stay, but we got to do it differently in Africa than you're going to do it in America. And I think there's an increasing awareness that in America it's going to be more inclusive in terms of human sexuality, and in Africa there's going to be freedom for that to be, for there to, them to be where they are today. I then asked them, what have you heard about doctrine? And they said, well, we've heard that in America you no longer care about doctrine, that you no longer believe. So they've heard the same things that were being shared here. So I think data is just really helpful. And we've used Menti polls when I speak at various conferences. So I just wanted to share with you, this is, if you go to the next slide, there we go. And I'm gonna read this in case you can't see it, but which of the following historic essentials of the Christian faith do you affirm and embrace? This was the North Carolina Annual Conference last June when I spoke there. So 98% of the people affirmed the Trinity. 95% of the delegates affirmed the divinity of Christ. 85% the virgin birth. 96% Christ's death for us and forgiveness for our sins. 97% the resurrection of Jesus. 98% the Holy Spirit at work in us. And 94% that the scripture is the primary source for hearing and understanding God's word to us. Those numbers, they didn't ask the exact same questions, they asked some kind of similar questions of Southern Baptists across America. Across America, we rate higher than the Southern Baptists did on those things. These are delegates to annual conference, keep in mind. But, you know, these are folks that if they were going to be jettisoning doctrine, maybe it would be those folks who are the leaders. But these leaders who said, we affirm all of these things. Now, you look at the virgin birth, and 85% believed in the virgin birth. You go, oh my gosh, well, 15% weren't sure about the virgin birth. Well, they if you talk to them, they'll say, I believe in the theology behind it, but I'm not sure about the biology of it. But I just remind people when you see that, the first person to doubt the virgin birth was a very righteous man named Joseph. And Mary came to Joseph and said, you know, an angel told me, I'm gonna have a baby by the Holy Spirit. And Joseph said, yeah, no, I don't believe that. So if Joseph struggled with it, it's not hard for us to understand that some of our people will struggle with it too. So I thought I'd just share with you a couple others. Go to the next slide, if you would. This is from the Arkansas. I had a gathering with Arkansas United Methodist in September of 2022. The Trinity, 95%. Divinity of Christ, 96%. The virgin birth, 86%. Christ's death for us and forgiveness for our sins, 92%. The resurrection of Jesus, 93%. Holy Spirit working in us, 98%. Scripture is the source, primary source of hearing and understanding God's word, 93%. I'm just saying, again, you look at that and you might go, well, what about the 7% who didn't think that? Well, these percentages are higher, again, than many of the national polls of conservative evangelicals. So I'm just saying, when people say the United Methodist Church is jettisoning what we believe, I'm wondering, where are those United Methodists who want to do that? And I spent a lot of time with folks across the country and other parts, not just in the South, and we find the same thing. This is at Church of the Resurrection's Leadership Institute. 1,285 people took the poll with us that day. You see the same numbers. This is just what it looks like. All right, so from there, I want us to think for just a second about the conversation that we've had about the kind of where United Methodist churches are. And you've seen this, you've heard a lot about it, and really I'm pretty sure we're close to the point we don't have to talk about this anymore. But if you go to the next slide. I didn't think that was in there. Keep going. There we go, thank you. So this slide, you may remember, is describing, was at least thought to describe how United Methodists functioned. So the first time I saw this was from Rob Renfro and I'm trying to forget his colleague, Tom Lambert. We were at General Conference in 2016 and they said, you know, Adam, they took four pieces of paper and they said, Adam, you just don't get it, but here is how we divide the United Methodist Church up. There are people who are, they call themselves on the far right, traditional non-compatibilists, and he said, we are them. And that is, if anybody is going to be allowed to have same-sex weddings, or if the doctrine isn't what we're, you know, what we hold to, we have to leave. And then on the far left, you have, so there was another piece of paper over here, and they said, those are the progressive non-compatibilists. And those are people who say, if everybody's not doing gay weddings, and everybody's not fully inclusive in the way we are, we have to leave. And then they said, there are people like you. And, you know, there are progressive compatibilists and traditional compatibilists, and there are people who say, look, I read the scripture this way. I don't think God's ideal will is for gay and lesbian people to marry, but I could be wrong about that. And so I realize that, and they could be right, and I want to stay in a church with those people who see it differently than me. But this is where I'm at. And progressive compatibilists the same. And here's what we know is that so they were right. They said, we're going to leave if the discipline's going to change. Where the vast majority of United Methodists are in those two middle categories. We've been a church of the Via Media. We're a church of people who say, look, I care about inclusion a lot, but I understand that you're not where I am, and I wasn't always where I am, and so I want to be in a church with you, and vice versa. And so what I'd like to ask you all to do for a second, I'm going to share with you where Resurrection is, because I had a couple of years ago, probably 5 years ago, I had one of our members say, Adam, you don't understand, the silent majority of our church are not with you. The vast majority of our church doesn't agree with you, and they're not with you. And I'm like, well, that may be right. They said, why don't you take a poll? And I don't like doing polls on divisive things. It's like taking a vote. But I thought, well, we'll do it. So we had a gathering. We had about 1,600 of our Resurrection people came to this gathering. And I said, you know, this is where I'm at. This is where the United Methodist Church is and what we're debating. And I'd really like for you to be able to weigh in. And let me know which of these four categories. And I explained them all. And we took a poll. And I remember standing there on the chancel in front of our people at this. It was our church conference, actually, is what we were having. And I thought, depending on the results on the screen, I might be leaving them as their senior pastor. Because if they really are in a very different place than I am, this probably isn't the right church for me anymore. And so anyway, I was anxious to see. I'm going to share our results in just a moment. But I want you to turn to each other. In fact, I want you to just, I don't know, is there a little piece of paper or something? If you can get your phone. And I'd like for you to write down where you think your church is. So would you do that? Take before you talk to anybody else, I'm going to give you 60 seconds. And where would you think, what percentage of your people are in each of those four categories? Does that make sense? Now. All right, so don't talk with each other yet. Just write down what you think, and then you're going to share that with somebody around you in just a second. So on the left, progressive non-compatibilists, if everybody's not doing same-sex weddings, if everybody's not going to be where I am, I've got to leave. On the right, if everybody's not where I am and we're not going to do them, I got to leave. All right, go ahead and turn to one another. I'm going to give you a couple minutes. I'm going to give you 3 minutes to talk about this with the folks sitting around you. All right, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, so tell me how many of your congregations are a majority in the middle between those two middle categories? I'm pretty sure all of yours are, you wouldn't be United Methodist still, right? You would have left. And you might have left on the left, or you might have left on the right, but the vast majority of our people have always been in the center. And what changes that is if you can scare people into feeling like you gotta go one of the other directions, right? Because by nature, we've been in Sunday school classes with people, and they see things differently than we do. We've been in Bible studies together. We worship together. We have family members who see things differently than we do. So it takes fear to move people out of that. So I'll just show you, this was the year 2000. There you go, you got it up there. So this was resurrection in January 2020. I'm pretty sure we've shifted a little bit, but it was probably pretty close. 3% of our people were out of here. This is what showed up on the screen while I'm standing there. I didn't know what the answers are gonna be. And so 3% were progressive non-compatibilists. Like, we're gonna go if this denomination isn't gonna have everybody officiate at same-sex marriages, full inclusion in every way. 4% of our people, so this was the quote silent majority of our church, was 4% of our people who were saying, we're out of here if we loosen the restrictions on same-sex marriage. 22% were traditional compatibilists. They were like, this is my church and I understand and I could be wrong, but I think I am right now. And 71% of our people were progressive compatibilists. So 74% and 26%. But really, the key number was 93% said, this is where I want to be. Now, we've been talking about this for a very long time. So we'd lost 800 people back in 2004. So, it was easier for us to be there. Today, I will tell you, at Resurrection in Kansas City, we are known as, we're the largest church in Kansas City, but we've also been pretty vocal. We're not leading the charge everywhere, or we just are clear, everybody's welcome at Resurrection. And it used to be that we have what's called Coffee with the Pastors, where people join, and it used to be at Coffee with the Pastors, I would field questions and people would ask me about this. And then when I told them, where I was and, that we were church for everybody, including more conservative people, but this is where I personally was, then we'd have people decide not to join. Today, I just tell them up front. So we have Coffee with the Pastors as our joining class, and it's gonna happen this Sunday afternoon from 2 to 4. And near the end, before they decide whether they're gonna join, I just say, I wanna share with you something just so you're not surprised, and I don't want you a couple months from now to hear me say something and decide you wanna leave the church. So I just want you to understand where we are as a congregation in terms of fully including everybody. And that's socioeconomic, that's racial, but that also includes sexuality and gay and lesbian people and their families and transgender people, that they're gonna be welcome here. And I said, when we read the Bible, we know that there are a handful of verses that speak about this, but we also know that there's several hundred verses that allow for slavery in the Bible. And we know that there are verses that tell women to be silent in the church. And as for Paul, he doesn't allow a woman to have authority over a man. And we know that the priest was supposed to take his daughter if she became a prostitute and burn her alive. And so we read these things and we have to ask, what's the historical and cultural context? And our hermeneutical principle here at Resurrection, that is the way that we read scripture, we read it through the lens of Jesus. So Jesus is the lens by which we read everything else in the Bible, and love is our hermeneutical principle, which John Wesley said the same thing. This was his hermeneutical principle, how he interpreted scripture. And this is why John Wesley looked at I was reading just yesterday again, his sermon on free grace and how he talks about predestination. And you know, I don't know if you probably know, he wasn't a real fan of predestination. I know you know that. And but he comes out really strongly against it. And then he talks about, but you will quote to me the scriptures that say this. And I love what Wesley says. He says, whatever they mean, they cannot mean that. And so, you know, the sense of we're interpreting all of the scripture in the light of some key hermeneutical principles. And this is what I tell those folks. And I say, so I just want you to know that, you know, this is a congregation and we've been working towards full inclusion for our denomination. And afterward, nobody leaves, because we have this break where they can then leave if they don't want to join. And it's kind of just a very simple, nobody leaves. And afterwards, I'm greeting all the new members. And they're like, Pastor Adam, that's why we come to this church. That's why we're here. I mean, we love all the stuff, this church, but we love the fact that this is a church where our friends are welcome and our coworkers are welcome and our kids are welcome. And so I see that as a bright future for United Methodism today. If you look at all the polls, you're gonna see that an increasing number of people in America pretty dramatically have said we're in favor of fully including everybody. And I wouldn't wanna be starting a new denomination today whose organizing principle was we are not going to include everybody. And so I think we have a bright future. All right, so anyway, when I think about reading the Bible, part of what and I've just finished a series on Paul. So we did for Lent, we did the Gospel According to Paul, which is probably gonna become a book somewhere down the road, but I invited all of our members, yeah, this is how it works. The Church of the Resurrection is my guinea pigs and we try things out. So for Lent, we did the Gospel According to Paul, which as you know, is the earliest gospel that we have. So the first gospel, Mark, was probably written after Paul's death, and the other one's long after Paul's death. And so the earliest account of the resurrection is Paul's account in 1 Corinthians, we studied Paul's letters, and I asked our congregation, I want you to read, we asked them to read one gospel a year. So every year we want you to read one gospel. If you're a follower of Jesus, you should read a gospel every year. But this year I said, I want you to read the Gospel According to Paul. And so we took his 13 letters and we broke them down by 3 chapters a day, and they read them through the season of Lent. And one of the sermons was on the hard sayings of Paul. And you may not experience this, but I know a number of people who are like, I'm not a big fan of Paul. And for a variety of reasons. My daughter was one of the first people who told me this. I was getting ready to preach on Paul about 20 years ago, and she said, she was 16, and she said, I hate Paul. I go, wow, that's some pretty strong words, little girl. Why do you hate Paul? Well, he's a male chauvinist pig. And I'm like, well, to you he is, but in the first century context, maybe not, if you understand him contextually. So anyway, we spent some time talking a few weeks ago about the hard sayings of Paul, and we walked through, you know, predestination, and we walked through slavery and what he says, we walked through what he said about women, and we walked through the passages about homosexuality or human sexuality. And part of what we find is, again, if we understand him in his historical context, and we read him in the light of Jesus, and we read him in the light of his best sayings, we have a little more patience with him. And then we're able to go, okay, we can appreciate this while still raising questions. And this idea of raising questions, some of you were at the gathering last night, but I wrote this book a few years ago, actually it's been about 10 years ago now, called Making Sense of the Bible. Some of you may have this book. I wrote this on a sabbatical leave, and I thought maybe this will help United Methodist Christians, or really any kind of Christians, to be able to think about the Bible. How did we get the Bible? Where did it come from? How do we look at it? And you know, for a lot of us, even in mainline churches, we read the scripture after, you know, at church on Sunday, we say the word of God for the people of God, thanks be to God. We don't say that at Resurrection. And the reason why we don't say that is because it's an oversimplification of an idea that leads people to believe that the Bible says it, I believe it, that settles it. In the New Testament, we talk about Scripture. So Jesus is the Word of God, and then we realize that the text of the Bible, written by humans, inspired by the Holy Spirit, but nobody knows exactly to what degree or how we explain the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Even the fundamentalists don't know how exactly to explain that. But we recognize the Spirit was at work, but humans are writing, and they're writing a particular time and place, and they have names, and they have stories, those people are writing. And God has spoken in the text and through the text, but it needs a little interpreting sometimes. And so for us, we say, what do we say? Right after scripture reading, thanks be to God for the gift of scripture. Or, may God open our ears to hear and our hearts to receive what we hear in scripture today. But being careful about oversimplifying how we think about and talk about the Bible. All right, so a story I shared last night from a book, and I include this in this book as well, a book by A.J. Jacobs called The Year of Living Biblically. Maybe you read that book. And a nominal Jew who decided that he would live the entire 613 laws for 1 year. And at the end of the year, he was gonna write a book about it. So it was really about writing the book. But so he did this, he let his ringlets grow long. He obeyed all the kosher laws. He put pebbles in his pocket before he left the house every day so he could stone people if he saw somebody who needed to be stoned, hoping they wouldn't feel the pebble hitting them. But and halfway through the year, he came to this place where he said, I came home and my wife said to me, you remember what the Bible says about women when a woman is on her period? And during that time when she's menstruating, you are, I think she asked him, what does it say? And he says, well, I can't touch you. I can't touch what you're laying on. I can't touch what you're sitting on. You're ritually unclean. And she said, right, follow me. And she went and sat on every chair in the house, laid on every bed in the house, laid on the floor in the house. And she said, what are you gonna do now, bud? And he said, at the end of the year, he reached this conclusion. Everybody picks and chooses. The important thing is to choose the right things. Now, I don't actually think picking and choosing is the right way to talk about it. I think it's rightly interpreting scripture. We're meant to rightly interpret it, the minor chords in the light of the major chords. We're meant to rightly interpret everything in the light of Jesus, who is the only inerrant, infallible word of God. And even him we only know of through the writings of human beings. And so we read everything in the light of Jesus, the commandments to love, which is what Jesus said. He said, the whole law and the prophets hang on two commandments. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and one gospel strength. And love your neighbors, you love yourself. And then he said, there's one more that everything hinges on, and that is do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. So in any case, he reached that conclusion at the end of that year. I was speaking in Ohio at a conference. This has been, 6 or 7 years ago. It was a pastor's group, just like you all. And there was a pastor on the front row who I think today is GMC. And he said, you're just picking and choosing when you're not holding the line on homosexuality in these passages in the Bible. I'm like, okay. I said, I just want to ask, and I said, so you don't pick and choose? No, of course not. It's the word of God. I'm going to follow the word of God. And I said, great. Let me ask you a question. Do you have an account with the United Methodist Pension Fund? And he said, well, of course. I said, what part of Jesus' words did you not understand when he said, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust corrupt and thieves break in and steal? Now, that's pretty clear, but you've somehow managed to say it's okay for you to have a pension fund account, and you're right to do that, but I'm gonna suggest to you that you're interpreting as well. You're asking questions of how do I read this text in its literal sense, and then how do I interpret it in the light of the historical and cultural context and setting? All right, this comment from John Wesley says, he says that no scripture can mean that God is not love or that his mercy is not over all his works. And everything in the word of God should be judged in proportion to the nearness of its relation to what is there laid down as the sum of all, the love of God and our neighbors. So he's just telling us what his hermeneutical principle was when he was interpreting scripture. One other little reading from, I've already showed that. Anyway, okay. So let's move on. But before we do that, one last little thing. I've gotten in trouble with some folks for talking about the Bible as fitting into one of three cups or buckets. Anybody heard the bucket thing? Adam Hamilton believes the Bible fits in buckets. So if I could have done it differently, I would have used file folder or something else. Bucket sounds sort of, anyway. So I just want to tell you what exactly that I have shared with people. When I read the Bible, so I had a man who came to me, and this is a story in the beginning of Making Sense of the Bible. One of our founding members, he was the Speaker of the House of the Kansas Legislature, one of the most influential men in Kansas. He was in his 70s, and he called me one day on my day off. His name was Wendell Lady, and Wendell called and said, Adam, I gotta talk to you today. I'm like, okay, come, Wendell, it's my day off, come on out. We'll have a glass of iced tea on the back porch. I was afraid he had cancer. That's how he sounded. He was just that distraught. And he came to my house, fixed him a glass of iced tea. We sat unsweetened, just so you know, it's not the same as what you drink down here. But we sat on the back porch, and I said, what's up, Wendell? What's going on? He said, well, you know, you asked us to read the Bible all the way through. And I said, absolutely. He said, I did it. I'd never done it. My whole life as a Methodist, I'd never read the Bible all the way through. He said, I am deeply disturbed by what I read. I'm like, well, talk to me about that. He said, did you know that there are 31 city states in the land of Canaan where God asked the Israelites to kill every man, woman, and child? I'm like, did God really call them to kill the babies? That's just wrong. And then he starts going through all of these things, you know, that he found in Scripture that were deeply troubling to him. And after he was finished, he said, I love Jesus. I've always loved Jesus. But some of this stuff doesn't seem to line up with Jesus at all. And I said, well, I kind of talked to him about the historical and cultural context. And I said, Wendell, as I see it, there are sort of three categories of Scripture. And I said, you know, and if you take a cup, I usually bring these with me, but if you take a big old cup and I say most of it fits in this category that's timeless and beautiful, and you hear God speaking through it, and it says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And what does the Lord require of thee but to do justice and to love kindness and walk humbly with your God and love your neighbors, you love yourself. And I said, there's just so much of it that we would just all agree. So you found the strands that weren't that. But I said, there's a smaller cup, and that smaller cup are the things that were important for the time but not important for us today. And the early church agreed with that in Acts chapter 15. And so circumcision and the kosher laws and a whole host of other things. So we eat shrimp and we eat pulled pork. And I said, but at the time, they weren't to do that. So we have to understand, why was that not okay at that time? But today, you know, we look at that and say, that doesn't really relate to us. And I said, then there's this little tiny cup. I said, that little tiny cup are things that when you read them, you look at that and go, what you're saying right now, I can't see how God could ever command a priest to burn his daughter alive if she became a prostitute. Or I can't imagine that God would want the babies to be killed. And so I said, we read those passages, and they're very small, but we read them, and we have to read them in the light of the major message of Scripture. And there are times we're going to say, I don't fully understand what was happening there or exactly what that means. I just know what this does mean, and this doesn't line up with this, and I'm going with this. Jesus loved prostitutes. He didn't try to have them burned alive. And Jesus elevated the role of women, and Paul's living in a historical context where in those churches that wasn't going to happen. In any case, the buckets are not saying these things should be taken out of the Bible. They're just saying we see the Bible's humanity at various places. And that's not a bad thing. But we have to read the lesser passages, or those kind of passages, in the light of the major themes of Scripture. And that's exactly how John Wesley interpreted Scripture. All right, let's take just a second. I want you to turn to somebody around you, and I'd like for you to have a chance to talk about, how do you talk about the Bible when people come to you and say, Pastor, the Bible says this. How can we be a church that's going to go against the Bible and allow gay people to get married in our churches, even if it's not in your church, in some church? So would you take just a second and just talk about how have you had those conversations about the Bible and human sexuality?
Thank you.
15 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one. All right. So you could talk about this for quite a long time, but I'm going to circle you back around. I need a gong. Okay, so I think this conversation is the hardest conversation for many people to have because we often have a way of seeing scripture that is not always scriptural. And again, this is why we're cautious about what we say when we're reading scripture in the service. The word of God for the people of God reinforces a very simplistic way of thinking about scripture as opposed to recognizing God speaks through the scripture. God has influenced the writers of scripture. But and I think back, if you go to, you know, 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is inspired by God and is useful for and goes into this. You know, even that, so this is what's quoted by the folks who hold inerrancy. You know this, inerrancy, the Bible has no errors in anything that it teaches about any subject matter at all, at least in the original manuscripts, right, which we don't have. And so, and which is always interesting, like if God made sure it was perfect in the original manuscripts, why didn't God make sure it was perfect in the transmission all the way through the process? But I had a guy who called me once, this has been years ago, he said, I'd like to have a debate with you about the Bible. Cool. This is a pastor of a fundamentalist church somewhere. I said, that'd be great. I said, he said, yeah, we could do it at my church. I'd like to, you know, and I think he thought, I'm just going to skewer Adam Hamilton and make sure that people know how stupid he is. And I said, that's terrific. I said, but before we have the debate in front of your congregation, can we just talk a little bit on the phone? So he said, well, of course. I said, so you believe in inerrancy, right? Yeah, that's right. The Bible's inerrant in everything it says. It's totally true and trustworthy and everything. I said, terrific. I said, so in order for me to win the debate, all I would have to show is one error in the Bible. Is that accurate? Yeah, you can't find an error in the Bible. I said, okay. I said, so it's only just to ask you a question here instead of in front of your congregation. I said, where did Jesus ascend to heaven from? And he said, well, I don't remember. I said, well, it depends on which gospel you're reading. Because in one gospel, Jesus ascended to heaven from Bethany on the Mount of Olives. And from the other gospel, one of the other gospels, he ascended to heaven in Matthew's gospel from the Galilee. And that's 90 miles north of Bethany on the Mount of Olives. I said, both of those cannot be true. So one of them may be true and the other one may not be, or neither of them might be true and maybe somewhere in between. But I said, I believe that counts as an error. There's an error somewhere. And this is like a big Jesus story. And I said, so we could go on to the resurrection and we could talk about the resurrection. Was the stone rolled away after the women arrived or was it rolled away before the women arrived? Were there two angels sitting inside the tomb, one on either end of where Jesus' body lay, or was there one angel sitting on top of the stone? Or was, and when exactly did Jesus appear? And I said, so we could do that. How about we could go to the birth of Jesus story and we could go to Matthew's account and Luke's account, and there are things that just simply cannot be reconciled together. And I said, that doesn't even get into the actual factual errors that we know today exist when it comes to some of the Hebrew scriptures, you know, just details that are just not right. And I said, so would you still like to have that debate? And he said, no, I think maybe we'll just, you know, I don't know that we need to do the debate. My point is simply that we have oversimplified views of scripture. When Paul says all scripture is inspired by God, what did he mean? So he was writing the earliest part of the New Testament. So he meant the Hebrew Bible. All scripture. When he meant all scripture, exactly what did he mean? Did he mean every single word in the Bible? Probably not, because there were already differences in some of the, you know, in various scrolls you'd find, and even among the Dead Sea Scrolls, where they'd said it one way in one, you know, one book and another way in another. But you remember in his time, the Sadducees believed that the Torah was the only authoritative portion of the scripture, whereas the Pharisees accepted also the prophets and the writings. And so when you think all scripture, it wasn't a book bound together, as you all know, it was a series of scrolls, a library of scrolls, and some placed all the authority on the Torah, and others, like Paul, who was a Pharisee, also said the prophets and the writings are authoritative. They are inspired by God. The word inspired, as you remember, is theonoustos, which is a Greek word. It's a compound word. Theo means God, and noustos means breathe or breath or air, and so, or spirit. And so what does he mean? you know, when he says all scripture is inspired by God? Well, nobody knows for sure because he made up the word. It didn't exist. It doesn't exist in the Greek language until Paul uses it in 2 Timothy 3:16. So then we have to ask, well, what does he mean by that? Well, he only uses it once in the entire Bible. So usually you would look at one occurrence of a new word and then you would read it against the others, but you can't. So all scripture, all three categories of scripture are God breathed, is it God breathed in its inception? Is it God breathed as God speaks through it? Exactly what is meant by that? Or does it mean literally that God dictated every single word? No, it doesn't mean that. And so we're going to debate those things and we're going to say, yes, I totally agree with that. The law and the prophets and the writing are all breathed upon by God. And I would use the word influenced. Influenced by God as the biblical authors are writing. But it doesn't mean they were dictated by God. And then the point Paul's making is that they're useful, right, for correction and teaching and training in righteousness. Amen and hallelujah, and that's why we preach every Sunday, right? But it's not saying the Bible is inerrant and infallible. It's saying something different. But most of our people, even in our United Methodist churches, if they listen to Christian radio, they've heard inerrancy. If they talk to their friends, and it just kind of makes sense, of course, if it's the word of God, then everything's perfect in there. Anyway, my point is we've got to be able to have conversations that help people be able to read their Bible and to be able to read them critically, to be able to read the Bible in the light of the greater hermeneutical principles. All right, what's likely to happen at General Conference coming up in 2 weeks? How many of you are delegates to General Conference? Excellent, okay, so you all know all this stuff, and the rest of you probably do, but I'm not sure. So let me just mention, the thing you hear a lot about are the three R's. So if you go to the next slide. So the three R's, the first one is, they're in different orders, but I put them in this order. Remove prohibitive language about LGBT persons. So on the left is, I believe, though I'm not certain, but I believe it is the earliest record of the General Conference of 1784. And on the right is the Book of Discipline from 1968. Between 1784 and 1968, the Book of Discipline said nothing about homosexuality. And those were our most dynamic years of growth in America, in American Methodism. There was nothing said about homosexuality. And so what we're looking to do is return the Book of Discipline to what it was in 1971 before the 1972 Book of Discipline was approved when it comes to prohibitions and negative things about homosexual people. So we're going to remove that language. And when we removed it, we will continue to have in there all people are of sacred worth and have value, all of this. But when we remove the language, that means we become agnostic on this. We are not saying that if you are a traditionalist, you have to officiate at same-sex weddings. We are not saying that if you are a progressive, you can't officiate at same-sex weddings. We're saying what the Book of Discipline had always said, and that is that pastors decide who they're going to marry. And so we will remove this language that's in the Book of Discipline and return it to the Book of Discipline as it was in 1971, at least when it comes to the prohibitions. We're going to have a revised social principles. Anybody here read the revised social principles besides me? So a number of you have. Good. If you haven't, you should read them. You can go online and just search for revised social principles. They are excellent. They've been worked on for years. There's people from around the world who are part of it. The statements in there are, again, things I'm very proud that as a denomination, I don't agree with every single word here or there. There's some things about farmers and the people, farmers in Kansas wouldn't agree with some of the things that are in there. We don't have to agree with all of it, but I can be really proud that we as a church say the gospel has to do with everyday life and what's happening in our world, and it has to do with moral and ethical issues. And what happens with the revised social principles, it's all been relooked at and been looked at from the entire world and not just Americans, not just people in the U.S. And so Africans played a part in it and other people around the world. And the language that was harmful around LGBTQ persons or negative around LGBTQ has been lifted out as well. So it's been completely rewritten, but it largely, much of it looks the same as what we've had before. It's an excellent, excellent document, one that I think the Africans who were a part of this are very proud of, the Filipinos, the people around the world were very proud of. So we're gonna hopefully approve a revised social principle. And then finally, the regional organizational structure. So that is something that we have tried to do before, and what the regional organizational structure says is that instead of central conferences, we'll now call them regional conferences, and the U.S. will become a regional conference. Regional conference, central conferences currently can adapt certain portions of the Book of Discipline. The U.S. cannot. We're going to allow everyone to be able to adapt the Book of Discipline. We're going to make the U.S. on a par with what have been the central conferences and have them be the regional conferences. And that means General Conference will probably not be 11 days long in the future, but maybe 4 days long. It's going to deal with just certain parts of the Book of Discipline that everybody should stack their hands on. And then we're going to allow the Book of Discipline to be adapted for the context in each culture and the political context in which the church exists around the world. That requires, it's a structural change to our Book of Discipline. It requires a two-thirds majority to pass, which I believe it will pass, but then it requires adaptation from approval from two-thirds of the annual conferences, and that's where it's a sticky wicket, and it will require great interpretation. The last time we tried this, because it's really important, it's important from moving the church from being a U.S.-centered church to being a church where every region of the church has the ability to be what it needs to be in its region. We tried this before. It got defeated at the annual conference level because, again, it was seen as a proxy vote, and so conservatives thought it was liberals who were trying to do something, and liberals thought maybe the conservatives were trying to pull something over on them, and so in the end, it didn't get the two-thirds annual conference approval. I hope that that won't happen this time, and it's approved. All right, so those are three of the big things that are going to happen at General Conference. I hope at least two of the three. I want you to turn to somebody around you. You have 2 minutes to talk about how do you feel about these things happening at General Conference, or what questions do you have? All right, so you have 2 minutes. And if you want to stand, why don't you stand, because you've been sitting a long time. Can I listen in? Thirty seconds. Fifteen, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right. So what I really want to focus on in the time that I have left with you is what's happening in American Christianity today, and why I think United Methodism maybe one of our best hopes for connecting with non-religious and nominally religious people. So go to the next slide if you would. And today there are 40 million people, that's probably a conservative estimate, who used to go to church, who used to be members of a congregation, who no longer are. Right? And we call them nuns, because when they take the survey, these are not atheists or agnostics, these are people who say, I am nothing in particular. Right? And so go to the next slide if you would. And this is a bit of data that came out. This was released in March. It comes out every year. Gallup has been doing this since 1937, or a predecessor organization has. And this is U.S. church membership. And it's not just church membership. It's also membership in a synagogue, a mosque, or a temple. And notice in 1937, 73% of the population were members of a congregation. And look how long that went, and roughly the same number. Even as late as 2000, 70% of Americans reported a membership in a church, a synagogue, a mosque, most of those in churches, right? And then look what's happened in the years since 2000, so the last 23 years, this goes through 2023. And today, 45% of Americans claim a membership in a faith community. That's a decline of 25 percentage points of the American population during that period of time. 25 percentage points. This is like nobody's ever seen anything like this before. And so if you take out the people who died, and you know, now we have children who grew up not going to church, so they don't really count as part of the 40 million I'm sharing with you. So there's 80 million people in America today who say, I'm not a part of any particular faith community, but I used to be. Well, actually, that's not correct. 25% who are not a part of a faith community. But anyway, the way the numbers work out, the way the numbers work out is that if you take away the people who died and you don't count the people who never belonged, you have about 40 million people who used to belong and don't belong today. So they've dropped out. At Church of the Resurrection, we started in 1990 to build a Christian community where non-religious and nominally religious people are becoming deeply committed Christians. These are the non-religious or nominally religious people. Some of them say, I have a deep faith in Jesus. I just don't believe in the church anymore. I've been hurt. I don't go. A lot more of them say, you know, I'm not really sure about my faith, but I'm spiritual. But they're not identifying as atheists or agnostics. The number of atheists and agnostics has doubled in our country during this period of time, but the doubling is from 2.5% to 5%. So we still have a significant number of people, atheists 2.5% to 5%, agnostics 2.5% to 5%. But a large number of people say, I'm not atheist or agnostic. I'm just nothing in particular. That's the 40 million we're talking about. So one of the questions that I want to know is, first of all, I'd say one of the questions I want to know is, what's the impact of those folks not coming? So go to the next slide if you would. So all of this came out just in the last couple of months. This is from a report from the Pew Research Center, and they wanted to look at nuns and what impact no longer being involved in faith communities has on people. 30% less likely to have voted in the last midterm, so they're less likely to be involved in civic involvement. 50% less likely to have volunteered in the last year if they're not a part of a faith community. And they were 50% more likely to report that they felt lonely in the last 7 days when they studied these folks. And this quote from NYU sociologist Eric Kleinenberg says, captures something important. He says, clearly more Americans are spending Sunday mornings on their couches, and it's affected the quality of our collective life. So something's gonna happen when you have 40 million people, 25% of the population, after you separate those pieces out that I mentioned, who are not involved in a faith community anymore. And so one of the questions I am asking, and I'm doing a sermon series right now in our congregation on this, 3 weeks, asking the question, and the sermon is called Faith Restoration. And we're asking, what kind of church would it take to see the 40 million, or at least some of them, come back? And I'm gonna propose three ideas to you, but first we need to understand why they left. So let's go to the next slide. So this comes from PRRI's Religious Change in America. This was released, I believe it was during Holy Week. Why 40 million people say they became nuns? So they surveyed 5,627 people last year, and people who were in that nuns category, 67% stopped believing what their religion taught. So it didn't make sense anymore. They had questions. Many of those people had questions, and they were told not to ask so many questions. And so they dropped out. 47% cited the church's negative teaching about LGBTQ persons. 32% said church was bad for their mental health. I want you to think about that. And really, what would a church experience be like for somebody to say, this is harmful to my mental health to go to church? But you know, there's a lot of churches out there that are like that. And sometimes our churches are that way for certain people in our congregations. 31% cited the sexual abuse scandals among clergy. Now, a large number of those were Catholics who had dropped out of church, but some were Protestants. This points to, again, how important it is that we are tending our own souls and making sure that we're not bringing harm to people, because we end up stepping into a relationship we never should have stepped into, or saying or doing things we never should have done. And I want to come back to that in a minute. 30% noted the church's polarizing politics. So of the 40 million, these were the responses of that 5,600 sample survey. And again, my question is, what kind of church would these folks who've dropped out potentially consider coming to, and what kind of Christian witness might they be responsive to in individual Christians? And if you were with us last night, we talked a little bit about this last night. I want to come back to the sexual abuse scandals. So this was, we have a picture in our mind of what that looks like when it comes to what's happened with children in churches. But this also included pastors having affairs with parishioners. This included pastors using their power or authority to hurt people, to harm people. And so I want to say a simple word, since most of you are pastors. So a story. At Resurrection, it's been 15 years ago, I had two young clergy on our team who were awesome. They were outstanding, and I knew one of them could have taken my place in the future. One of them was probably going to be an executive part of our executive team. Really terrific people. And serving on staff, they were each married to somebody else. They each had children. They were in the same small group, so they had a really close connection. And over time, they began to have feelings for each other. And somewhere along the way, they gave voice to those feelings. They talked about how they felt about the other person. Now, I totally understand how that happens. I understand how that happens because this is a lonely job sometimes. And this is a job where, so in my case, I remember, it doesn't happen today, but years ago, you know, I would go home from work and I was putting in 60 to 70 hours a week. And I'd go home and LaVon, my wife, was frustrated because I wasn't home more. And I'd get home and I'd be really excited, you know, after we said our evening prayer for the meal, and I'd start to talk and I'd start to tell her about the church and this really cool thing that we're gonna do and this is what's happening. She'd say, would it be okay if we just didn't talk about the church tonight at dinner? Okay. I'd come home and I'm, you know, having this really great, you know, this thing that we're working on, I'm so excited about. And it's like, do you think you could finally take out the trash? Like, how long do I have to ask you to before we get there? Now, she wasn't being mean. I was just totally oblivious to the things that were happening around the house. I remember one week we were in the middle of capital campaign meetings for it was 3 or 4 weeks in a row, and I'd been gone almost every night. And I'm gonna tell you, don't do as I do, as I did, but I was gone almost every night. It was this rapid phase of growth and resurrection. And finally she said, hey, this is not okay. I didn't sign up for this. You know, and I would try to be home for dinner with the kids, but then I would go back to my evening meetings. And she said, I just need you to know this. I'm not okay with this. I said, okay, I'm gonna fix it. I'll be home tonight for dinner and I will be home the evening. I've got a finance committee meeting. I'm gonna go kick it off and then I'm gonna come home. Now, this is in the days before we had cell phones and the ability to text. And I'm sitting in the finance committee meeting and I'm thinking, shoot, this is a really important conversation. I can't leave. See, this church is so dependent upon my opinions at this finance committee meeting, I cannot leave. And so I stayed, and I kept thinking we're gonna be done, and it wasn't done, and I kept running and running, and we lived right behind the church, and it was 2 hours later, and I finally went home. And I could tell I was in trouble because the lights were all off. And fortunately, the back door was unlocked, but I walked in, I saw my plate sitting there on the table, she'd already put the kids to bed, and I knew she was still awake, and I walked upstairs. My pillow was sitting outside the locked bedroom door. And I got the message, and I knocked. I said, hey, I am so sorry. She said, I know, you're always sorry. And I said, please let me in. Let's just talk. I really am sorry. And you know, she opened the door, and she said, I don't know how to be more clear with you that this is not okay. Right? And we managed to patch it up, and then you know, we did that again 4 or 5 more times over the next 10 years. But here's the thing, you go home and you're just the guy who forgot to take out the trash. And you're in the office working with somebody, a coworker, another parishioner, and you're doing this thing and you're gonna change the world for Jesus together. And there's an excitement and a connection that happens. right? And this person isn't complaining. They're just excited. They just think you're awesome. You are just awesome. You're the pastor. You're awesome, right? And weird feelings happen. And yeah, I've been pastor for 33 years at Resurrection, and two or three times I had weird feelings. And I realized if I take three more steps that direction, I'm gonna destroy my family, and I'm likely gonna have a huge impact on this church. But in your mind, you rationalize, it's all gonna turn out okay. I met with this young couple who were, so they, you know, started having these feelings, and they would stand next to each other and pray in their small group and hold hands, and there was a little energy there, and then one day they told each other that they had feelings for each other. Can I tell you, if you tell somebody you have feelings for them and they're not your spouse, one of two things is gonna happen. Either they're gonna think you're the weirdest, creepiest person they've been around, and you're gonna feel really stupid, or they're gonna reciprocate or start thinking maybe something's there. And then how many more steps do you take before you just destroyed your family or your credibility or somebody else's faith and their family? And so I mention this to you here because you're human. There's not a person in the world, given the wrong set of circumstances, might not have a funny feeling about somebody else or an energy or a sense of when you're super lonely and things aren't going well at home and all of a sudden there's somebody who treats you like you hung the moon. And you see, you're all safe people for people to have those feelings about because you're the pastor. You're a pastor. Now, I might feel something towards you, but I know you're holy enough that you're not gonna have those same kind of feelings towards me. And you're super attractive because you represent holiness and godliness and God, right? You're far more attractive than you actually literally are because of who you represent. And so just, you know, being aware of that, because there have been two or three times in the last 33 years, again, if I'd taken three more steps in that direction, it could have turned out horrible. So figuring out who can you talk to about that when that happens, or when other people are saying things to you that get your mind thinking. And I'm not gonna tell you the stories, but there've been some really the kind of stories where I said, LaVon, I need you to ask me about this person. I have a meeting with them now and I'm getting kind of weird feelings. Anyway, just guard your heart. Because whether you believe in a literal devil or the devil as the dark force that's at work in the world and in all of our lives, you have a target on your back. And I will just tell you, 42 years of married now, I'm so grateful that the Holy Spirit was able to say, stop, you're being stupid and you're gonna hurt people. Anyway, that's the 31%. So when it comes to the kind of church that might appeal to these folks, the 67%, 47%, 32%. What we're about to do is, I hope, remove a roadblock from the 47%. We're gonna say, this is no longer our policy and everybody is welcome in all of our churches, even if we're a little more conservative or a little more progressive. But I wanna talk about, let me just give you three ideas. These are the three sermons this month at Resurrection. Last week's sermon was Eruditio et Religio. Eruditio et Religio, a church for critical thinkers. So if you went to Duke, you recognize Eruditio et Religio. It is knowledge and vital piety, or knowledge and religion. And this was from a Charles Wesley hymn. It was actually a prayer that he wrote for parents raising their children. Unite the two so long disjoined, and those two things that were so long disjoined are knowledge and vital piety. And so we're talking about how are we being a church for critical thinkers. I want us to think about this for a second, because all those people, the 67% who've had questions, we're a church where we say it's okay to have questions. We're a church that says it's okay to, we don't want you to check your brain at the door of the church, but instead to bring your brain with you. We're a church that says we want you to be able to be critical thinkers when it comes to your faith and when it comes to scripture study. So a church for critical thinkers. I wanna remind you of something that when Jesus was asked, this is in Matthew chapter 22, verses 36 and 37, a lawyer comes to Jesus, he says, which is the greatest commandment? You know the answer already. And the first greatest commandment in verse 37, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your being, and with all your mind. So in Matthew's account, it doesn't say strength, but with all your mind, all your mind. So the Greek word for mind is dianoia. Dianoia is a word that, noia is your mental capacities, and dia is through. And so dianoia means you love God with your ability to think through things. You love God with your critical thinking skills. I thought this was interesting. Jesus used this term in a Greek dictionary. You'll find dianoia, critical thinking. So we are meant to love God with our minds. We're meant to ask questions. It's okay to ask questions. Having doubts is not, doubt is not the enemy of faith. There's a book that I shared on last night with a group of folks. This is Wrestling with Doubt, Finding Faith. It's a book that came out of a sermon series that we wrote, that I wrote in 2022. And what we did is we surveyed people. 1,000 people took the survey. We wanted to know, do you wrestle with doubt? 95% of people wrestle with doubt. Like, everybody wrestles with doubt sometimes. And I love that, the kind of patron saint of doubters, when the man who had a son who had epilepsy or demon possessed him. And he says, you know, Jesus, you know, if you're able, heal my son. And Jesus says, all things are possible to those who believe. And you remember his response, Lord, I believe, help thou my unbelief, right? So anyway, the book was written to, first of all, it starts off just in praise of honest doubt. The doubt is a good thing, not a bad thing. I wish more Christians doubted today, because there's a lot of Christians that just believe things, stupid things, hook, line, and sinker. They don't even ask questions. I was watching a Pentecostal preacher, Kenneth Hagin, the other day. Something came across my newsfeed. I was looking for things related to the apocalypse, or not the apocalypse. He was talking about the apocalypse, the eclipse. There we go. So, for this weekend's sermon, I wanted to include something about the eclipse, and I thought, I wonder what different people have said, and I knew there'd be some goofy people say stuff. And Kenneth Hagin is a Pentecostal who said, this eclipse is a sign from God that Jesus is coming back at any moment. This is one more sign, along with the 4 blood moons from last year, and this and that. And he's, you know, putting it all together. And like, we need to be ready, church, because the Lord is coming back at any moment. Of course, the congregation's cheering, yes, the Lord's coming back at any moment. So this just brought back memories for me, because when I was in high school at the Pentecostal church, this is what we heard all the time. Jesus is coming back at any moment. And my wife and I got married the week after high school graduation. I was 17 years old, because Jesus was coming back at any moment. And there was one thing I wanted to experience before he came back. It happened on your wedding night. So, I mean, you know, that's a little over-exaggeration, but not much. I mean, it was like this sense that the Lord is coming back at any moment. And somewhere along the way, it's like, okay, wait a second. We can predict when eclipses are going to happen. We can go back and see when they happened in the past, because we know how they happen. We know what's going on. We understand blood moons, right? These are things that are naturally occurring phenomenon. And again, I wish some people were more attuned to critical thinking when it comes to their faith. But here's the thing about you, is you are a church that started on the campus of Oxford University, uniting together vital piety and education. You know, we started 1,000 colleges, universities, and schools around the world, Methodists did. In the United States, there's 113 of them still related to the United Methodist Church, 11 historic black colleges, more than any other denomination, 113 schools here in the United States. In Kansas City, the very first public school was started by the Methodists in the basement of Westport Methodist Church, the first four-year university in the Kansas territories, Baker University, named after Bishop Baker in Baldwin City, Kansas. We started state schools. We started, Kansas State was started by Methodists who came together, said we need a school for everybody to learn about agriculture. I mean, this is a part of who we are. We have a lot of little schools, but we also have the schools you all know so well. So we've got Emory that we started, and Duke, and Northwestern, and you know, even USC was started by the Methodists, and so was Vanderbilt, and you know, all these great schools, because we believed in the union of the intellect and faith. The early Methodists, those Holy Club Methodists, started teaching children in Oxford who were kids of coal miners, right? Because we believe that every kid, education was really important. So what happens when you're a church that champions this? This goes into our partnerships with schools. How many of you have partnerships with schools, public schools in your community? If you don't, think about this. So at Resurrection, we have 36 public schools that we support. We have 13 in Kansas City. We could devote millions of dollars to this every year. Not every year. We devote $1 million a year, millions of dollars over the years that we've been doing this. We have schools that we fund completely in other parts of the world. But what we tell preschools, we're starting or expanding 4 preschools in Kansas City. Why do we do that? Because we believe that education matters. It's important. And here's the thing, for people who are non-religious and nominally religious, the 40 million, but they hear what you're doing with the schools, with their children at the schools, and the way you're supporting low-income kids, and you're providing sack lunches, and we have a beds program, so every kid in Kansas City gets a brand new bed, mattress, box spring, sheets. We provide pillows, jammies, and all of this for any kid that we find out doesn't have a bed in Kansas City. You know, we have 3,000 kids receive the sack lunches every Friday to last them through the weekend. We have tutors who tutor in the schools. We devote hundreds and hundreds of hours, literally thousands of hours in the schools. Here's my point. A church that cares about the intellect and faith, that's willing to ask hard questions, that's willing to encourage people to become critical thinkers, is a church that might just reach the 67% of people who said, faith didn't make sense to me anymore. Faith working through love, a church that loves radically. So if you go back to, there we go. So that's this weekend's sermon, faith working through love, a church that loves radically. And so for Wesley, he was a theologian of love. He was, driving passion, his understanding of sanctification, it was all about love. And not a warm, fuzzy feeling, but it was all about how do we love selflessly, sacrificially, agape. And here's what this weekend I'm gonna be challenging our people. You know, in our individual lives, what does it look like to actually practice that kind of love? What does it look like in every encounter you have with another person? What does it look like when every Sunday we take, so there's, in your church, I don't know, 100 people, 200 people, 500 people? So every week when I give the benediction, I do it like this. Like their eyes are closed, their heads are bowed, but here's how I picture it. I'm throwing them out into the world. Like you are on this mission, from the moment you walk out, you are on this mission to go out, and your mission, it's just a super simple thing. It starts with radical love, right? Which is not a way of feeling, but it's a way of acting. So what happens when we're actually doing that? What happens when people who feel like they've been burnt by a church that had pastors who were sexually abusive, polarizing politics in which they're demonizing other people, churches where people's mental health is compromised when they go to church, and they come to a church where people are just made to feel loved the moment they walk in the door, right? And where love goes for everybody, doesn't matter who they are, right? And they're sent out to live out love in the community. That's the kind of church that non-religious and nominally religious people will be drawn to. And the last one is incarnated faith, a faith to heal a broken world. So if we are a faith for thinking people, if we're a faith for critical thinkers, if we're a faith that just loves people radically, there's nobody in the world that doesn't want to be loved, right? Not a single person in the world, even our animals. I have two pets. I took a video yesterday morning, before I came here. And one of our dogs is Rocky. They're both mutts, super mutts. They're just like, but Rocky, he sleeps in his kennel. When we let him out, he jumps on the bed, he goes crazy. LaVon always lets him out. He comes up and he jumps and he gets right in my face. And he places his paws firmly on my chest, and then he wants to lick me. Now, I don't like dogs licking me. I'm sorry, I know some of you like that. I do not like it. I'm like, stop, Rocky, stop. But this dog desperately wants to be loved. And I think my dogs would die if they weren't loved. And those are just pets. But all of us need to be loved. There's not a person among those 40 million who doesn't need to be loved. The question is, who's gonna love them? Who's gonna go out of their way to show kindness and compassion and love and mercy to other people? And I think it's a denomination who understands that the goal of the Christian life is to grow in love, to be sanctified. And so I think we're a church for all of these kind of people. And I think we have an opportunity as United Methodist to be a church that reaches them. So there are other denominations that will do the same, but I think for United Methodist, we have a huge opportunity right now in a world where there's 40 million people who no longer go to church. All right, I wanna mention one other thing about critical thinking. And politics, polarizing politics. So I was watching a sermon in California last week, and again, it came across my Twitter feed, just a little 30-second blip, and I thought, okay, I gotta watch this. And there's this visiting preacher, and he's preaching to this congregation of about 2,000 people. Strange it was in California, but there's churches, all kinds of churches everywhere. And he was talking about politics, and he was talking about religion, and he was talking about the people on the other side who are the woke Christians, and are not woke Christians, just woke people, and how the devil's using them. And then he put up a picture of his favorite presidential candidate up on the screen, and people started roaring and cheering, and you know, it was just, this whole thing was whipping people into a frenzy the whole time. You know, and I got to the end of it, I thought, this is scary. These are people who've moved from being political supporters to being called by God to be willing to even die if need be for their presidential candidate, right? And I'm watching this and I'm thinking, this is one of those places where we've gotta raise up people who can be critical thinkers. I'm not endorsing any particular presidential candidate. I can find some good in almost everybody. But the ability to invite our people to think critically in the light of their faith becomes really, really important. And when I share this with our congregation, when Christianity and religion, or Christianity and politics are too closely intermingled, so our faith should influence our politics. There's no question about that. But what can happen sometimes, as we all know, is that suddenly it's our politics influencing our faith. And then we start using Jesus, and we start using the church, in order to further these goals, and we no longer can see any more clearly that what's happened is Christianity is lost. And religion always loses when we're intermingling in the wrong way, politics and religion. Last thing I want to say about this is when it comes to critical thinking. So the Pew Public Research, PRRI, found that Christians were twice as likely, I'm quoting from them, Christians were twice as likely to believe conspiracy theories spread on social media than religiously unaffiliated people. Isn't that sad? Right? Or this information, 2019, so this comes out of MIT's Technology Review, published in 2021. In 2019, 19 of the top 20 Christian Facebook pages were run by Eastern European troll farms. The only one that wasn't was Guideposts. All of the other top 20 Christian Facebook pages were fake. And to that was in the lead up to the 2020 election. In 2016, so Christianity Today published this, it was found in 2017 that Russian operatives created a popular Facebook page to target conservative Christians with patriotic Jesus-filled memes as a broad social media campaign to stir dissension among Americans in 2016. We have to talk about this stuff. By the way, did you know, I don't remember the exact number, and this isn't a knock on this news station, but I think UMCOM said that 40 to 60% of United Methodists watch Fox News exclusively. So these are people in your pews. And again, Fox News, they're trying to be a little more balanced. I'm really grateful for that. But I'm just saying, you have to be encouraging people to be critical thinkers. All right, so I want to begin to wrap this up. I've got a few videos I'd like to show you and just talk about this idea of wrestling with doubt. So guys, if you'll go to that video with the woman's face on it, and don't play it yet, but this was the sermon series promo we did in Christmas Eve 2021 for the series on doubt. I'm going to share this with you because I want to encourage you to think about, if not preaching a series on this, doing a series in your Wednesday night programming for your people on doubt. And the book, I'll tell you the chapters in a minute, but this was the promo we showed. We always, on Christmas Eve Candlelight, we plan a January sermon series we call a fishing expedition that's designed to appeal to the people who come on Christmas Eve who don't normally come to church, to see if they might come back. We do the same thing often at Easter. So go ahead and play the promo.
There's a gray river of doubt between my head and my heart. They say seeing is believing, but I only see myself reflected in the currents of the great unknown. I need a savior to carry my head and heart on.
So these are the chapters in the book, and these were the sermons in the sermon series. So I did an introduction with In Praise of Honest Doubt, but then the first one is there a God? And we looked at the question of science and faith, and try to understand what is the case to be made for God. I don't have time to talk about all these things with you today. I did this last night, but is there a God? The second is the good book with a question mark, and wrestling with the Bible, and things we've already talked about here. The third, and these were all the questions from a 1,000-person survey. These were the top questions that they had, the doubts they had. So number three was, are all non-Christians going to hell? And I'll just read you a little bit of the opening of that chapter. This was from a young man who I've mentored in the past. He was a Pentecostal pastor who left his faith and his church and now considers himself an agnostic with Christian roots. And he says, the question about other religions is one of my biggest struggles with the whole Christianity thing. I cannot accept that a good, kind, loving, gracious, just God would send a kind, caring, loving, faithful Hindu to hell simply because they didn't accept Jesus. That literally makes no sense to me. And in the chapter, we talk about three different ways you approach the different religions. There's exclusivism, universalism, and then there's inclusivism, which was John Wesley's approach to the other religions. And it ends with a sort of surprising quote from John Wesley. The next chapter was, is heaven real? So people, they may not have faith, but they do want to know when their loved one dies, is there really a heaven? I'd like to know about that. When prayers go unanswered, and then why do the innocent suffer? And so I want to go to the why do the innocent suffer. And there is an episode of Young Sheldon. If any of you watch Young Sheldon? Okay. So there's an episode in season three that I thought was a most remarkable bit of television entertainment, really, dealing with critical issues. So mom, I think, is it Mary? So Mary finds out that a 16-year-old girl in her town has been killed. And she's struggling with her faith. And she comes to the point, she goes to the preacher, and the preacher doesn't give her very good answers, and most other people, and she has been raised with this idea, this overly simplistic faith that everything happens for a reason, and it must have been the will of God, and all of a sudden she's realizing that doesn't work. And so with no answers and her own struggles, she Saturday night she goes out and gets drunk, and Sunday morning she doesn't go to church. And this is deeply troubling for young Sheldon, who, as a young person, is as a kid, considers himself an atheist, but he wants his mom to have faith. And so I wanted you to see this beautiful scene where young Sheldon is sitting with his mom as she's questioning her faith. Take a look.
So you don't believe in God anymore?
That isn't something for you to worry about. I need to figure this out myself.
Can I help? Maybe I could provide a fresh perspective.
I don't think so, baby.
Did you know that if gravity were slightly more powerful, the universe would collapse into a ball?
I did not.
Also, if gravity were slightly less powerful, the universe would fly apart and there'd be no stars or planets.
Where are you going with this, Sheldon?
It's just that gravity is precisely as strong as it needs to be. And if the ratio of the electromagnetic force to the strong force wasn't 1%, life wouldn't exist. What are the odds that would happen all by itself?
Why are you trying to convince me to believe in God? You don't believe in God.
I don't, but the precision of the universe at least makes it logical to conclude there's a creator.
Baby, I appreciate what you're trying to do. But logic is here. And my problem is here.
Well, there are 5 billion people on this planet, and you're the perfect mom for me. What are the odds of that?
Thank you, Lord, for this little boy.
How many of those 40 million people do you think are like Mary in that show? It's the number one reason why people leave faith, really, if you ask the theological questions. So I can't make sense of a world where there's suffering that happens. And what would happen if they found a church like yours that doesn't believe that everything happens for a reason, if by that we mean that God wanted terrible things to happen to people? What would happen if they came to a church where you asked really great questions, like if God's will was that terrible things would happen and people were sick all the time? Why did Jesus come and heal them? Why didn't he just say, I'm sorry, but this is the will of God that you're sick? And what happens when they come to a church and you're not offering, you know, easy answers like, well, it's all gonna be okay. Don't worry about it. Jesus is gonna heal you if you pray hard enough in his name. But instead you say, you know, our bodies are subject to illness and God's way isn't normally to miraculously stop the laws of nature. And accidents happen. But God walks with us through the pain. And that the central focus of the Christian faith is that God came and walked among us and he was tortured to death. But that wasn't the final word. And because of Easter, we know, as Buechner has said, or Brueggemann, somebody, has said, the worst thing is never the last thing. And there's always hope. And then in Christ's resurrection, he demonstrated in the most powerful way God could that evil and hate and sin and death don't have the final word. That at Easter we see that light has conquered darkness, love has conquered hate, and life has vanquished death. That's what we offer, not some sort of overly simplistic answers. All right. I want to encourage you, as we prepare to wrap up, to be communities that are building bridges in your city. So we started, we had a vision in 2019. We said, what do we want to do over the next 10 years at Resurrection? What is God calling us to do? I'm going to retire in 2030, so what does this look like between now and then? And one of the things we said is we were hyper-polarized, and Church of the Resurrection is a bridge-building congregation. Methodists are, because we have both Republicans and Democrats. We bring people together from the left and the right. At Resurrection, 40% of our members are Republican, 40% are Democrat, and 20% are independent. And we think that's a gift. And so we said, what if God's calling us to be a part of depolarizing our city? So we decided we would launch every 2 years a campaign while the political election season was going on. And I thought I'd just show you, if you'd go ahead and go to that next, let's see. I'll go to the next one. This was our campaign in, go to the next slide if you would. This was our campaign in the year 2020. It was the Love Your Neighbor campaign. We had 5,000 political, 5,000 signs printed up that were on the corner. Every street corner where there were candidate signs, we had one of these signs. In the yards of our members, we had these signs. We had the t-shirts, we had the coffee mugs. I preached into it for 4 weeks. We had a whole, we had a focus for a month. We're gonna do everything we can to love our neighbors, particularly those we disagree with. And it was awesome. And one of the things we happened, we found unchurched people ask us for the signs. Can we get some of your signs to put in our yard? It's like, yes, you can have some of our signs. And it had an impact on our city. 2 years later, we came back with the B campaign. Go ahead and go to the next slide. And the B campaign, this is one of the signs in Ohio, because we gave this away to other churches, and there were about 500 churches across America who used this. And it was, be just, be kind, be humble. Micah 6:8. So we take a scripture that nobody can disagree with, and Micah 6:8, be just, be kind, be humble. We had the t-shirts, we preached into this. We had, this time we had billboards. We had radio spots, TV spots. And it was all about, what does it look like for us to be just, be kind, be humble to our neighbors? We also then started classes where we brought people together and focused things. We brought people together who were on different sides of an aisle to have conversations together. And I thought you might enjoy seeing this. We did this with the local NPR station. So would you play that next video? Well, actually, that's this coming campaign, Do Unto Others. But go to the next video. Yeah, there we go. Go back. We just skipped ahead there.
So I think we disagree on virtually everything.
I think we probably do.
What made you want to come here today and do this?
So I've lost a couple of people in my life recently due to politics. And one of them, she was my best friend for 10 years.
Wow.
And I just think we can't live like this as a nation. And, you know, the only way we're going to be able to stop that is if you and I sit down and we have a conversation and we talk about our similarities and we also talk about all of our differences and we just appreciate who the other one is for whoever they are and wherever they came from in their background. And, you know, I think if we did that more as a society, I think we'd probably be in a better place. What made you decide to come here today?
I'm asking myself that question right now. Well, when Adam talked about it in the sermon, it sounded like a good idea. I have, like I said, I have three sons. I have one who is left of Bernie Sanders. I've got one that's, you know, right of whoever on the other side. And so we just got things we don't talk about. And it's like, is that really the best way just to have things that are completely off limits? Or is there a way to disagree respectfully?
I figured you would be further to the right, so I feel like my assumption was that you would be further, and the reality is that you are probably closer to the middle than was I who you expected to be?
No, I didn't expect you to be so nice. Would you be more guarded, maybe? I don't know. All right, so we're going to go get coffee sometime?
I think so.
So these two ladies have become really good friends. And it was a model. We did this with a number of different sets of people, Republicans and Democrats. And we had small groups who were doing the same thing. And it managed to start transforming, you know, people. And then inviting other people to do that across the city. And it's been cool. So go back to that picture of the Do Unto Others campaign. I'm mentioning this to you because we would love for you to join us in this. There's probably 1,000 churches that are already committed to doing this. Some of the largest churches in the denomination. We have all the materials prepared for you. The little heart shape is Republican red in the top and Democrat blue, and then it becomes purple in the middle. Do unto others. Jesus says the law and the prophets are summarized by this great commandment, or by the golden rule. And we'll have TV spots, things you can use online. We're gonna have, you can download all this stuff, put your own church's name on them. But imagine if the people in your community saw, let's say they saw signs from this church in people's yards all around that were calling them to do something good in the middle of a polarizing time. That's evangelism. That's working together for a common good. That's inviting people to be transformed by the church. And I think only the church has the power to do that, but most churches are not going to pursue this during the election season. And I'd like to invite you as United Methodists to consider doing this in your congregation. So you can go to cor.org and then actually you might just, I don't remember the website. You'll have to go online and just search for Resurrection Do Unto Others campaign. And you'll get the information from there. And we'll provide, we'll have PDFs, we'll have all this stuff ready to go. I'm gonna take 5 minutes and we're gonna close. We're gonna close it just a minute late. But I wanna end with this. And I shared this last night for those of you who were there, but thinking about all those people who are non-religious and nominally religious today, it seems to me that we are in a place where we need a new Jesus revolution. There was a film that came out last year, Jesus Revolution. It was about the Calvary Chapel churches, and they had their problems and issues, and Chuck Smith was their pastor, but there was a piece of it, and the film showed some of the problems, but there was a piece of it that I thought was so powerful and compelling. And I wanted to share just a little bit of this with you. So I'm gonna have you guys go down, and if you'll skip down, you're gonna go down to the Time Magazine. So in 1971, this was the cover story of Time Magazine. Keep going. This is all the stuff I had to cut out. I'm sorry, I wish I had a little more time. I didn't use my time well. But let's go to the next slide. Keep going, there we go. So that was the Jesus Revolution, 1971. You remember all the hippies were coming to come to know Jesus, and it was, you know, and some people were pretty turned off by that. But these were people who felt, they were the non-religious and nominally religious of the 1960s and 70s. And they were trying drugs and everything else. And they finally found that maybe Jesus might be the answer. And so this film was capturing that period of time and the way that this particular church decided to embrace people who were outside the church, as Jesus did. So go to the next one, and this is the promo for the film. This is the trailer.
These people are hippies, rebels against old-fashioned authority.
I think these kids need help.
They need is a bath.
You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about.
Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
When God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about. Because I do not understand.
This house has a very good vibe. There is an entire generation searching.
Slow down.
Just in all the wrong places.
Why bring them in? I'm going to lose my job.
We can only walk through doors open to us. In your church, that's a door that's shut.
You've probably noticed we have some guests here today. I'd like you to meet my new friends. Welcome.
They don't belong here. Half of them aren't even wearing shoes.
They need our help.
I was almost done with this, but then you did what nobody else would even dare.
This thing that we found, I feel like I belong.
Our country is a dark and divided place, but now there's hope, and it's spreading.
This is your home.
So I watched this movie sitting at my dining room table. I didn't go to see it at first because I thought, oh, it's another one of those conservative Jesus movies, and I'm probably not going to like it. But not that they're all not great. Some of them are awesome. And I always tell people I'm a conservative liberal and a liberal conservative too, depending on what issue and what day of the week it is. But I want to show you this next clip. And this next clip captures what happens when they start welcoming these people into church. Take a listen.
These kids are runaways, most of them. They got drug addictions, medical issues.
Yeah, Chuck. I mean, they need to go home. They're making our congregation uncomfortable.
Well, maybe they should be uncomfortable. Maybe we all should. Maybe it's my job to make us uncomfortable. I haven't been doing it.
Chuck, stop. This is enough. This is a house of worship. And yes, we expect a certain level of dignity here. These girls are wearing halter tops, and half of them aren't wearing shoes.
They're stinking the new shag carpet with their bare feet.
Oh, yeah, let's be sure to save the carpet.
You keep this up and you're gonna drive away the only contributing members that we've got. You hearing me now?
Loud and clear.
I wonder if that ever happens in Methodist churches in the North Georgia Annual Conference. So anyway, it was the next scene, and this is the last one I'm gonna show you, that led me to start crying as I was sitting at my kitchen table. Because it captured why I became a United Methodist and why we started Church of the Resurrection to reach non-religious and nominally religious people. Take a listen.
Good to see you. Enjoy. Welcome to church. Hello, young lady.
Well, last year I had the privilege of visiting New York City. I'm not getting a tourist. I paid a visit to the Statue of Liberty, and I read those famous words. Give me your tired and poor, your huddled masses, yearning to breathe free. And as I read those words, I thought, well, that's Christianity, isn't it? It's the essence of it. An invitation to the broken. Jesus was very friendly with the outcasts. In Revelation 22, it says, let the one who can hear say, come. Let the one who is thirsty, come. Let the one who desires take the waters of life freely. I want you all to look at me. Please. Every one of you. This place, it is yours. I don't care if anybody else thinks so. If you feel like you're an outcast, then join us here. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, this is where you belong. If you feel ashamed or trapped in something you've done or are doing, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here. No guilt trips. This is your home. And I want you to tell all your friends about it. There is a place for you. Now that door is open all the time for you, any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door is open for you too. It works both ways.
I showed that because I feel like that's what we just went through as United Methodists. To decide who are we and what kind of church are we going to be and who's going to be welcomed and loved in our congregations. And you're still here. We're all the old guy who went and sat with the younger people, even though some of you are young. And I love that. So now it's time to begin. This is a new beginning for the United Methodist Church. And it's not necessarily we're all on the same page. We're just all saying, we're in this page, and we're going to love everybody, and we're going to be okay if there are people on the other side, and we're not going to fight anymore. We're going to focus on being a church for thinking people, where people can ask questions and not check their brain at the door of the church. We're going to focus on being a church that radically loves when people walk in the door, and we're going to send people out to radically love in the world, and we're going to be a church that seeks to heal a broken world. And I think that kind of church is going to see a large number of those non-religious and nominally religious people saying, that's exactly what I thought the church was supposed to be all along. So I came here today just to, I've rambled a little bit, I'm sorry, but I just came here today to encourage you and to remind you of who we are and to be people who say, this is a new day and we're kind of starting over, and what an exciting time to be United Methodist Christians. So I'm going to invite you to put your hands on your lap like this, like we're going to offer ourselves to Christ. And you might just whisper this under your prayer. Here I am, Lord. Use me. Fill me anew with your Holy Spirit. I offer all that I am and have to you. Use me, I pray. Bring revival in our churches. Help us to welcome and love everyone, and to be your presence in this world. In your holy name. Now, Lord, help us to mean what we say as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Hey, it's been great to hang out with you today. Thank you so much for being here. I do hope you'll consider two things. One is the Do Unto Others campaign. Think about that. The second is, we don't have any of these books left. They sold out last night, but I would love for you to pick up this book and consider doing a study on it in your congregation. And there's videos that go with it, but as a way of really thinking about the kinds of questions people are wrestling with today. And then lastly, I'm gonna hang out outside. I think they have a few books left. I'm gonna sign whatever's out there, I think, until I have to go to lunch. So I look forward to seeing some of you out there today. Hope to see some of you in Kansas City sometime at our Leadership Institute. And again, thanks for letting me hang out with you today. Jessica, I'll turn it back over to you.
Friends, we got work to do. Amen? And it is a good time to be a United Methodist. And there is a great world and a great beginning that we're gonna undertake. So I hope that you will continue the conversations that we are having here as colleagues, that you will continue them in your churches, that you will continue them in your communities, and that people will come to know the love of Jesus because you have shown them his love in the way that you love them. So get out of here, go meet Reverend Adam Hamilton. But let's just thank him again for coming out to be with us. And I love you, and blessings on your work. Go in peace.